if we look at the state of human rights and democracy in this country today, well, for democracy to exist, democracy is not merely what some people feel, that it just means the right to be able to go and cast your vote for your representative. This is what some people have come to believe, that this is all that there is to democracy. For democracy to really function anywhere, you require the rule of law, you require protection of various fundamental rights, particularly the right to speech, the right to protest, the right to organize and meet, etc. And of course, the freedom of the media. If we look at the state of all this today, if we just look at the rule of law, what we find today is a very, very alarming state of affairs. On the one hand, we see in UP in particular, all these fake encounters taking place almost on a daily basis by the police, where the government and the police are taking great pride. They are not even shy to admit that these are fake encounters. They just say that, well, we just killed criminals. What's wrong with killing criminals in cold blood? I mean, this is the kind of language that is now being used by the UP government, it's the spokesman of the BJP, and even some sections of the police about these encounter killings. I mean, they seem to have completely forgotten, or they have become totally brazen about the rule of law, that you cannot, nobody can kill even a criminal in cold blood. And it's the job of the police to arrest him if there is a charge against him and bring him to trial. Then there is there are lynch mobs all over the country, where any group of goons can come and beat up people in the name of cow protection, in the name of love jihad, and it's happening across the country almost on a daily basis. And we find the more alarming thing is that it is not only happening, but the police is siding with these mobs in most parts of the country, particularly in states which are ruled by the BJP. We also have a lynch mob on the social media, where if you say anything against the government or against some of these BJP leaders, etc., then you are liable to be, it's called trolling, but you are liable to be abused in the most filthy language. You are liable to be threatened with death or rape if you happen to be a woman. And we are seeing something quite extraordinary happening in this country, which I have not seen happen anywhere in the world at any time of history that I am aware of, that you have a prime minister who is virtually leading and controlling this pack of wolves or this lynch mob on the social media. Swati Chaturvedi has written a book, I Am a Troll, in which she has elucidated in great detail how the Prime Minister himself controls and manages this entire BJP IT cell, which in turn controls this lynch mob. And further evidence of the Prime Minister's direct encouragement to this lynch mob on the social media is that he invites many of these people who use the filthiest language, threaten people to kill people or to rape people, etc., that these people are invited to the Prime Minister's residence for tea, where he takes, allows them to take selfies with him and then allows them to put them up on their Facebook pages saying proud to be followed by the Prime Minister. So, we have not, at least I have not seen this kind of a thing, and I am not aware of this kind of a thing happening anywhere in the world. I mean, we have seen that all kinds of thugs and goons have become prime ministers and presidents of various countries. I mean, Trump is an example. But this kind of mob being led by the prime minister and virtually openly led by the prime minister, I have not seen anywhere. We have a media which has been brought totally to heel, where we find that far from dealing with or tackling serious issues which confront us, whether it is farmer suicide or these people who clean these sewage deaths, etc., etc. I mean, there are so many problems and issues that we see across the country, but we find that there are large sections of the media who day in and day out are just engaged in trying to promote communal hatred, communal polarization, etc. People who speak out or even draw cartoons run the risk of being charged for sedition. A lot of them are charged for sedition in the country, though that's completely in violation of what the Supreme Court has declared about the correct interpretation of the law on sedition, though this is a colonial law which should have been eliminated from our statute books. But the Supreme Court had read it down to say that it's not sedition to promote disaffection against the government. It's sedition only if you are inciting people to violence or public disorder. And yet we find that people who are just lampooning the Prime Minister or criticizing the Prime Minister are often being charged for sedition. We have all these draconian laws which are being misused. The National Security Act, nobody has a clear idea of how many people are today imprisoned by way of preventive, because this is an act which allows preventive detention on the government's apprehension that this person may cause some disturbance to foreign relations, he may cause some disturbance to public order, etc., etc., gives very wide powers to the government of preventive detention. And this young boy, very fine boy, Chandrasekhar Azad Ravan, one of the young Dalit leaders who has emerged in this country, first they charged him with some 30 cases. In all those 30 cases, he got bail. Thereafter, they put NSA against him where he couldn't even get bail. And for the last 17 months, he was in jail. Finally, they released him because they perhaps feared that the Supreme Court would come down on the government. The case was coming up before the Supreme Court. You have the UAPA, which is now being used against some of our finest human rights activists who have a absolutely stellar record of trying to protect human rights of Dalits, of Adivasis, of other human rights defenders, etc. And now the government is going after them by fabricating supposed letters. And when this case was heard in the Supreme Court about these supposed letters which the government is using as justification for arresting them, just supposed to be letters written mostly to or from one comrade Prakash, and that comrade Prakash in that Sai Baba's judgment is supposed to be Sai Baba, and all these letters are supposed to have been written at a time when he was in jail. Yet these totally fabricated letters, and in these letters you find that some Marathi script is also used when the persons who are supposed to have written these letters or received these letters don't have a computer which has the capability of writing the Marathi script, etc. So there are so many indications to show that these letters are fabricated. These letters say that we'll carry out a Rajiv Gandhi style assassination of Mr. Modi. They say that we have paid 10 crores for procuring arms for the Maoists, all kinds of absurd things. And these letters are not even produced before any court, etc., by the police, but they are just circulated to the media. And the media, and then some sections of the media, use these letters to say urban Naxals, urban Naxals, urban Naxals. Just as earlier they used this term tukde tukde gang to target people like these JNU activists, Kanhaiya Kumar, Umar Khalid, etc. So you create this myth, you use the media to create this myth of urban Naxals, etc. And then, and it's all done in a very organized and planned manner. This urban Naxal thing starts with some fellow called, some failed filmmaker called Agnihotri or something. He then, thereafter it's picked up by this Republic TV and Times Now, etc. And thereafter it is, we find that these same letters which are shown around by Republic TV, etc., are being used by the police against these human rights activists. So you have Armed Forces Special Powers Act being used again and again to protect security forces and their officers who have committed heinous crimes from being prosecuted for them. I mean, I don't understand how anybody, any army officer or anybody can say that, look, if you don't protect us from being prosecuted for crimes of rape and murder, then we can't do our duty of providing security. I mean, of course, you have a right to fire in self-defense. You won't be prosecuted for that. You are only prosecuted if you have carried out a cold-blooded rape or murder or things like that. And how can anybody, any police officer or any security officer say that we need to be protected from prosecution for cold-blooded rape or murder? That in the absence of that protection, we won't be able to do our duty. But that all these laws are still persisting in our statute books. Maya told you about the state, Maya and Colin told you about the state of the police. I needn't elaborate on that. Other institutions like the judiciary also. I mean, Colin said that the judiciary must see at the threshold, because today what is happening is that you make a false case against anybody, like they have made against these activists, etc. And if you just say that, well, let law take its course, and if the police, if the judiciary says, ki, all right, police has made this case, so let the trial take place, and till that time, let these people remain in jail, then what happens and what has been happening, everybody has been seeing that, is that people remain in jail for decades altogether, at the end of which they usually come to be acquitted, but their lives have been destroyed. Colin said that it is the duty of the judiciary to see at the threshold whether there is any substance in the case against them, and they should throw out the case at the threshold itself. I say one more thing. At the end of the trial, when they find that the police case was bogus and thereafter these people are acquitted, in my view, it's the duty of the court to also make a determination whether the charges that were brought were basis of, were on the basis of fabricated evidence or not. if they were on the basis of fabricated evidence, then it is the duty of the court to order the prosecution of the police officers who fabricated that evidence. Even in the parliament attack case, even the Supreme Court came to the conclusion that 3 out of 4 persons were acquitted in that case. Only Afzal Guru was convicted. That the case against those 3 persons was on the basis of fabricated evidence. And yet, the police officers who fabricated that evidence, on the basis of which they wanted to hang these people, those police officers were not ordered to be prosecuted. So therefore, that should be an additional duty. Of course, the fact that the trial goes on for decades is itself scandalous. There is no reason why we should have a judicial system where trials go on for decades altogether. At most, it should take 6 months or maximum 1 year. There is absolutely no justification for any trial to take more than 1 year. That requires serious judicial reforms, which unfortunately the governments, they are not at all interested in any of those judicial reforms. And then we have these institutions like NIA, CBI, which have been totally politicized and corrupted, much like the police. CBI has more professionalism, but the political control over the CBI and the use of the CBI for political purposes is perhaps even more than of the normal police. And then we have universities. We have been seeing, at least in the last 4 years, a very concerted assault on universities and institutions of higher education, particularly of higher education, because this government, being a fascist government, in fact, recently there was a book which has just been published called How Democracies Die. It's written by 2 Harvard professors. It's written in the context of America, in which these professors have pointed out that democracies don't die now by military coups, they die by elected demagogues who gradually destroy all the institutions that are necessary. Not just the institutions, they destroy the culture that is necessary to sustain democracy. So therefore, if you look at in this book, you'll find charts which gives you indicators of fascism. And if you see those indicators, maybe half of the indicators are already there even in a country like the US, in Trump's America, because the book has been written about Trump's America. But more than 90% of the indicators are present in this country. And when you have a fascist government does not want critical thinking to survive in the country. They want only order following people who will wear these khaki shorts, have a lathi and stand, and then if they are told that, look, you go and burn all these houses, they will just go and burn all these houses without questioning as to why you are asking them to burn these houses. What's wrong with the people in those houses? So they don't want critical thinking, and therefore there is a concerted assault, absolutely studied and concerted assault. In fact, if you remember, when this JNU issue started, the campaign of the BJP and its spokespersons were, they ran the hashtag on the social media called Shut Down JNU. Shut Down JNU. So JNU, which is arguably the best university in this country, has always been rated as the best university in this country, that they want to shut it down and they want to shut down. All such institutions of higher learning. That's what happens in a fascist state. So, and this idea of nationalism that is being promoted, that nationalism means hating Muslims. Nationalism means hating Pakistan. I mean, absolutely. Today, actually, Yogendra Yadav has written a very nice piece about this RSS in the Hindu. All of you should go and read that piece, where he has pointed out that the RSS is the most anti-national organization that you can imagine. It not only opposed India's struggle for independence, it not only opposes the Indian flag, the national anthem, etc., it opposes the very idea of India as a multicultural, multi-religious society. So therefore, we are, in conclusion, there is no doubt that we are facing not just an assault on democracy and rights, we are today facing an assault on civilization itself. The silver lining is that just as all of you have come here, just as the Jamia Teachers Association has stood up and stood steadfast in this struggle, there are a lot of people. In fact, when these five activists were arrested, there was a huge uprising in the whole country against that those arrests. So there is, we have a good fight on our hands. On the one hand, there is a fascist onslaught, one of the most severe fascist onslaughts that we have seen ever in this country. On the other hand, there is considerable, very brave resistance on in this country. We have some absolutely outstanding young leaders who are coming up in this country, people like Chandrasekhar Azad, people like Jignesh Mevani, people like Kanhaiya Kumar, many such examples. So therefore, people like Manisha Sethi here, so there are a large number of outstanding activists who are fighting against this fascist onslaught, and I have no doubt that we will prevail in the end. Thank you.